Five, four, three, two, one.
Broadcasting live from the Solihull Radio Studios, this is the Josh Samuel Show, your Saturday afternoon obsession.
Candles burning, ruby red, sheets are falling off the bed. Run your fingers through my hair. I know what you're thinking. Take me there. You hypnotize me with your touch, and I can never get enough of you. It's true. And anywhere you wanna go, my hand is only yours to hold. Oh, you know I'm so obsessed with the way that your lips kiss me like crazy. Ooh, you amaze me when you walk in the room. You got me losing. Yeah, I'm a mess. Girl, I confess, I'm so obsessed. Oh, yeah. Every time you walk away, I guess your perfume likes to stay on my pillow. On my shirt. Listen, baby, for what it's worth, I'm so obsessed with the way that your lips kiss me like crazy. Ooh, you amaze me when you walk in the room. You got me losing it. Yeah, I'm a mess. Girl, give it to me now.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to Solihull Radio. This is the Josh Samuel Show, your Saturday afternoon obsession. I don't know about you, but I think it's safe to say that World Cup fever has well and truly hit Solihull. I've got a whole host of reviews and previews to get through to the next couple of hours, but I shan't be alone this afternoon. After the technical mishaps from last week, I've got this week's star guest in the studio with me. He's a stand-up comedian from Leicestershire. He's also an avid Ipswich Town fan. The innovator of improv, the one-liner wonder, Tony Carrot, will be joining me in a few moments' time. And we'll be discussing each of this week's biggest talking points from the footballing world, as well as discussing his career as a comedian and life as a fan of the Tractor Boys. before giving him an Ipswich-themed quiz of his own, all of which will be coming up from around quarter to four. And as always, there are an almost endless amount of ways you can get in touch with me and Tony this afternoon. You can try and call me in the studio, fingers crossed it actually works this time, on 0121 777 8410, or you can send us a text on 075 64 30 30 64. Or, if you, as my good friend Sahil puts it, are still stuck in 2006, you can send us an email at studio@studyhullradio.com. And of course, you can tweet me at Sir Josh Samuels or Tony at Tony Cowards, or by using the hashtag The Josh Samuels Show or The JS Show. But we are kicking off today's show with some World Cup chat, and with that, another official England World Cup song. Last week it was Three Lions from 1998. Fast forward 4 years and one World Cup to a duo whose singing should never have been allowed to leave the shower. However, it is still a great song. It is We're on the Ball by Anton Deck. Some insight there into the wonderfully witty brain of Tony Cowards, who is joining me now. Great to have you opposite me this afternoon, Tony. Thanks for joining me. What have you made of the World Cup game so far, first of all?
Well, I unfortunately was gigging last night, so I missed the best game so far, the Spain-Portugal game. But yeah, I've been loving it. It's been all right, hasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, we've seen pretty much everything, haven't we? We've had the host, Russia, absolutely decimating Saudi Arabia in one of the most spectacular opening games in World Cup history. Of course, we've also had Uruguay and Iran snatching victories from the jaws of defeat right at the end. And then even Portugal and Spain, probably the most thrilling of the games that we've seen this afternoon. This World Cup so far. And even early this afternoon, France just about beating Australia, and then Argentina and Iceland currently drawing 1-1. I don't think the score has changed. So we've seen pretty much everything. Worth a 4-year wait, wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, definitely. I always love the World Cup. It's great.
So if we look at the first game, obviously, Russia beating Saudi Arabia. What did you make of Russia's performance? Because it wasn't a Saudi Arabia side that was particularly pressing as such. Russia, certainly out of the teams that qualified, the lowest ranked in the FIFA rankings. But surprising, not just themselves, but everyone as well.
Yeah, I thought Saudi Arabia didn't really look too hot, did they? But Russia didn't look too bad. I think Russia, the FIFA rankings thing is a bit of a slight red herring with Russia, isn't it? Because the rankings favour teams that have played competitive matches, and because Russia automatically qualified as hosts, they haven't played any competitive matches for a long time, so I think that's harmed their ranking. But yeah, I thought they looked pretty good. They scored some lovely goals.
They did, and even some of their substitutes coming on and doing the business. And also, we had Uruguay just about beating Ipswich. So, given that Russia's goal difference is therefore so big, does that then mean that it's almost impossible for Egypt, who did perform very well and still have yet to have their talisman Mo Salah perform for them, do you think that their chances of getting out of Group A are therefore significantly diminished because of Russia's goal difference and the fact that they lost to Uruguay?
Yeah, I guess it's going to be difficult for them now, isn't it? But is their next match? I don't know if their next match is against Saudi Arabia or whether it's Russia. But if it's Saudi Arabia, they can hopefully improve their own goal difference and get quite a big win. And then it all goes down into the last match, doesn't it? So.
And speaking of Uruguay, what did you make of them? Because in my opinion, I was expecting Uruguay to really, really take them to the cleaners, especially when Mo Salah was announced to be on the bench. But they did not make it at all easy for Uruguay. Uruguay really did struggle. They had to really grind out that result. And many people, many pundits, both on Twitter and in the studios on BBC and ITV, thinking that Egypt actually were the better side. So is it a case of Egypt with Mo Salah can really go on to really salvage something from this World Cup? Or is it a case of Uruguay, despite not playing well, are one of those teams that can grind out the results even if they aren't playing that well?
Well, I'll be honest with you, I thought that was a little bit harsh on Uruguay, because I thought Uruguay had far more clear-cut chances than Egypt. If Suarez had been playing how he normally plays, he would have got at least one or two goals. So I thought Uruguay actually did just shade it. Obviously, it was a late goal, and I think Uruguay really came into the game when they realised that Salah wasn't going to come on as a substitute.
Yeah.
Once Egypt had used all three subs, Uruguay thought, oh, right, we can go for this now. And that's when they got their goal. Thought Egypt didn't look too bad, but they didn't really have a cutting edge. You can see why they were obviously really sad to have lost Mo Salah for a little while.
So who are your picks to progress from Group A? I'm certainly going for Russia and Uruguay, not just because they both won, but I think they're just, it's just too far gone for both of the other sides. Where do you stand on that?
Yeah, I think I agree, to be honest. It does look like a Russia and Uruguay. It'd be interesting to see what happens in their match when they play each other. I don't think, obviously, Saudi Arabia, I don't think have got much of a chance. Egypt could still surprise people, but I think the odds are with Uruguay and Russia.
And moving on to Group B, we'll come on to the best game of the World Cup so far without question, which is Portugal versus Spain. Quickly then, Morocco versus Iran, what did you make of that game?
I was listening to that on the radio whilst I was travelling to my gig last night. So I only heard it, I didn't get to see it, but the first half sounded like it was quite a good half, and then the second half both teams seemed to cancel each other out a bit, and then of course Iran do what Iran do and kept it tight and then nicked a goal right at the end, didn't they, with their own goal.
And obviously
a bit unfortunate for Morocco.
Yeah, absolutely. And then there was Portugal and Spain. I mean, we're going to come to Cristiano Ronaldo a bit later, but what a player Cristiano Ronaldo is. Just, yeah, he's 33 years old. Just when you think we've seen the best of him, this is probably his last World Cup, and then he goes and scores a hat trick. Just fantastic, isn't it?
Yeah, he does seem to get better with age. He seems to be better now than he was sort of 5 or 6 years ago. I was looking; it was quite interesting because this is his fourth World Cup, and he scored as many goals in that match against Spain as he scored in the previous three World Cups. So,
just incredible. But what did you make of Spain's performance? Obviously, losing their manager just 2 days before their first game. We are, again, going to come on to that a bit later on. But did you think that they coped with the fact that they had to bring in this new manager so soon before their first game against arguably their biggest rivals, not just in the group, but in the World Cup itself? And do you think that the players responded well to Fernando Hierro's tactics and the way that he wanted them to play? Or do you think it was a bit reserved and a bit not quite sure what to do?
I thought
I don't know how much effect it really had on him. I mean, it must have been a bit of a shock to lose your manager, but Spain have most of those players for the Spanish team have played together for a long time. I mean, a lot of them are club mates anyway, either at Barcelona or Real Madrid, and so I don't know how much it affected them. I think they just played how they would have played under Lopetegui. And Hierro has been with the squad for a long time, so I don't know. I sometimes wonder. I think managers get a lot of the blame, or too much blame, when things go wrong, and probably too much credit when things go right. I'm not sure. Managers obviously do make a difference, but I don't think they make as big a difference as sometimes we're led to believe.
I think that is a fair assessment. Speaking of fair assessments, what is your fair assessment of France versus Australia? France, again, not necessarily being the best side out of the two over the whole course of the match. Australia did well to hold them for quite a lot of the game. But also VAR, that was quite interesting, wasn't it? Giving the penalty that really shouldn't have been, and then 5 minutes later, not even that, the penalty that was. Two penalty goals, Paul Pogba then scoring the winner. Do you think France have got a good chance of winning the World Cup?
Watching that match, I think I'm now put France as my favourites to win the World Cup, because they're clearly the jammiest team in the tournament so far, because I didn't think they played particularly well. As you say, they got a penalty that possibly wasn't a penalty. I'm still, after seeing about 100 replays, I'm still undecided whether the Australian defender got a foot to the ball or whether he got a foot to the ball but then committed a foul by tripping Griezmann, or whether it wasn't a foul. I'm still utterly baffled as to whether it was a penalty or not. And then their winning goal was just a bit of a lucky deflection off the defender, wasn't it? Looped over the goalkeeper. So I thought France, they look like they're a collection of individual great players, but I don't know if Deschamps has managed to make them into a team. I mean, he just seemed to pick the three sort of big name strikers, didn't he? Griezmann, Dembele and Mbappe. It's just like a kid playing a computer game where you just stick all the best strikers on the pitch and hope they score lots of goals.
I think it has been working for France over the last year or so, and they got the job done against Australia. And quickly, the game that is currently going on, Argentina versus Iceland, if you don't know the score, it is still 1-1, Argentina versus Iceland. Aguero scoring first for Argentina before Finn Ogbersen equalised 4 minutes later. Can you see Argentina taking that? Obviously, Iceland being the surprise team in the Euro 2016 Championships, surprising us again by managing to get an equaliser so early on against Argentina.
Well, One of my big predictions for the World Cup, that everyone has scoffed at when I've said it, was that I didn't think Argentina would get out of their group, because I think they'll lose to Croatia and possibly to Nigeria. I must admit, I thought they'd probably beat Iceland, and who knows, they still could. But yeah, if they draw against Iceland, I'll be definitely doubling down on my prediction that they'll come third in the group.
And very, very quickly, the big game, as far as we're concerned, of the tournament, or the first big game of the tournament, should we say, Tunisia versus England, Group G, Monday. Predictions?
Yeah. Well, every time a World Cup comes around, or a European Championship with England, try not to get too carried away, because, as we know, they've let us down in the past, and we've all been crying our eyes out. But I think this group of England players are a good group, and they seem to have a plan. Gareth Southgate seems to have a formation that he's happy with and a system of playing. So I think we'll do all right. I think England, the first games are generally pretty tight and pretty awful, really. But I think we'll win 1-0 or 2-0 against Tunisia.
And we've got a quick question in from my good friend Matthew, who will be on the show in a couple of weeks' time. He's asking, what do you think are Portugal's chances of winning the World Cup? Tony Cowart.
I don't think they'll win it. I think they've got problems in defence. They've got two very old centre-backs when they were playing. I think they've got a good team, and they'll do all right. They're probably quarter-finals or maybe semi-finals, but I can't really see them winning it. Although, having said that, and I've not always been his biggest fan, but Ronaldo is just seems to be incredible at the moment. So I suppose if one player can drag the team to glory, perhaps he could.
I say thanks to them for Final Four. Just a quick rundown of the official Josh Samuel Show Fantasy Football League for the World Cup. In first place is Martin Garner with 58 points. His team is, let me try and pronounce this, he's Pakistan. He had Jimenez, who scored and kept a clean sheet for Uruguay. Captain Ronaldo with his hat-trick. So very well done to him. We'll see what happens as this first round of fixtures draws to a close. I'm currently in third with 36, quite happy with that. But yes, we'll see what happens. I'll have another recap next week. So, if you've got any more questions for me or for Tony about the World Cup or anything else we are talking about, don't forget the number is 075-64-30-30-64. Or call us on 0121-777-8410. Or email us, studio@studyhullradio.com. In the meantime, here's some adverts from our sponsors.
Fed up with condensation every morning and hate that yucky mold patch in the bathroom? It's time to contact EnviroVent. They've helped tackle mold and condensation dampness in over a million homes, just like yours. To find out more and to book a free home survey, visit EnviroVent.com, because air matters.
Solihullradio.com.
Stagecoach Solihull teaches skills
in drama, singing and dance.
But these skills don't just vanish when the curtain falls.
They're skills for life, stretching imaginations and improving literacy.
For a career in the arts,
learning new skills,
or just having fun.
So visit our website,
www.stagecoach.co.uk/Solihull.
Stagecoach Solihull, skills for the arts.
Skills for life.
Yeah!
The Fireplace and Stove Centre, 1204 Stratford Road, Hall Green. Specialists in wood-burning stoves, gas and electric fires, with over 50 live displays in the showroom. Come in and experience your new fireplace solutions. Call 0121 777 8585 for more details.
You're listening to Solihull Radio.
Indian Dream on Dubhouse Parade, Solihull's premier family-run restaurant offering authentic Indian and Bangladeshi cuisine. With fresh ingredients and creative chefs, they can provide bespoke dining experiences, eat in or take away. 0121 704 9058.
In the hall, she said we need to talk. I can't go on like this another day. I froze in my tracks and a chill ran up my back, 'cause I knew she was gonna say. She said there's someone else and I've kept it to myself. I can't keep these feelings locked inside, and I need to tell you this. It's one of your old friends, one you haven't talked to in a while. She said I'm leaving and there's nothing you can do. I said I had a feeling you found somebody new. Now that I can guess his name, but it's so hard to believe. 'Cause he said you're not even close. It's someone you don't. Leaving you for me. I just stood there at a loss for words, trying to catch my breath, 'cause I knew that it was over when she said I'm leaving and there's nothing. I said I had a feeling that you found somebody new. And I'll bet I can guess his name,
said you're not even close. It's someone you don't know. I'm leaving you for me. She said you're not even close. It's someone you don't know. I'm leaving you for me.
A marriage break now at the moment. Technically I'm married at the moment. It's not going well. I realised it wasn't going well with me and my wife because every time we went to bed she wanted me pretending to be Sylvester Stallone. Yeah, we were going through a Rocky patch.
Just brilliant comedy there from Tony Coward. That was I'm Leaving by Aaron Tippin. So else has been leaving? He's a Spain manager, as we said just a moment ago. Julen Lopetegui, if I pronounce that correctly. I do speak Spanish, but whether he's from in Spain, I don't know the language. Anyway, so 3 days ago, he was the Spain manager. Then it was announced that he was taking the vacant manager's job at Real Madrid. Spanish FA didn't like that very much. They said, well, if that's the case, if you're going to do that behind our backs and we don't want you here, you can go, which they did. They sacked him. And then he was announced as Real's manager the following day, I believe, or I think it was yesterday. They then replaced him very, very quickly with their sporting director, Fernando Hierro, who I believe he captained Spain about a decade and a half ago, a legendary player in Spain. But you have to question the Spanish FA's logic with this. Are they doing this just to prove a point, or were they cutting off their nose to spite their face? Tony Carras, where are you on this?
It just seems like chaos, doesn't it? I don't think either side come out of it with too much credit. I guess because they found out, didn't they? The Spanish FA supposedly found out 5 minutes before he announced it to the world that he was going to be the new Real Madrid manager. I guess they just thought it was too big of a kind of an insult and lack of communication that they couldn't go on. But it just seems very odd all round, really. I suppose the Spanish feel like because the Dutch aren't there and the French don't seem to be having their usual kind of chaos and infighting, they needed to step up and provide the comedy fallout before the World Cup actually started.
Oh, well, certainly as far as I'm concerned, it is just utterly, utterly embarrassing by the Spanish FA. It just sounds like they've got all stroppy and bratty for no particular reason, really. And it's not exactly an arrangement that is unusual. We've seen it both with Louis van Gaal when he took over at Manchester United following the 2014 World Cup, Antonio Conte leaving Italy to take over at Chelsea after the 2016 European Championships. So yeah, it's not exactly an alien concept that a manager signs for a club after leaving his country or after an international tournament. So I just don't really see where Spain are going with this.
You're probably too young to remember this, Josh, but just before the 1990 World Cup, Italia 90, Bobby Robson, because he knew that he wasn't going to continue to be England manager after the World Cup, he'd signed a contract with PSV Eindhoven to become their manager. And there was a big controversy then, so it caused a quite big fallout in the England camp before the Italia 90.
Yeah, well, that's just another example.
England did all right in that, so maybe Spain
might want to win it again, who knows? That would be something they would it. What a story that would be. Spain sacking their manager, getting another one in 2 days before their first game, and they go on to win it. I mean, we'll probably get some sort of the equivalent of their knighthood, wouldn't he, Fernando Hierro?
Yeah, I think he'd become quite a big... He's already quite popular, isn't he? He was a big popular Real Madrid player and a Spanish player. But yeah, you know, it's quite an odd one. I do, you sort of say about the Spanish FA, I don't think Real Madrid are entirely blameless in all this as well. I get the feeling that Real Madrid are a sort of club that quite often do a lot of messing around behind the scenes, and there's quite a lot of political intrigue goes on with them, so I think they've kind of the masters of the dark arts as well, and I think they could have handled things a bit better.
Speaking of the blame game, naturally, as you mentioned just a few moments ago, managers can often get too much praise if things go well. They can also get too much criticism if things go badly. But given the fact that Spanish FA is kind of sorting all this out, they're the ones that decided that he had to go, they're the ones that decided that Fernando was to come in, So, if Spain, let's just say they do really bad, let's just say they go about in the group stages, who is to blame here? Is it the Spanish FA? Is it Real Madrid? Is it Lopetegui himself? Who is to blame? Even Hierro, could he take any of the blame for this?
I don't know. I guess it's a bit of everything, really, isn't it? I don't know if you can put your finger on one particular person. It does seem crazy, though, isn't it, that you're going into a World Cup where you'd think that everyone would be united, all looking to go forward together with one goal of obviously winning, hopefully winning the World Cup, and then for it all just to collapse in infighting. It does seem a bit strange. But I'll be honest with you, I said before, I don't expect this to actually affect the Spain team too much. I know they only, perhaps they were hoping to beat Portugal last night, but it was a good game. Both teams played well. De Gea made a bit of a silly mistake, otherwise they probably would have won the game. Ronaldo obviously almost pulled Portugal through just through sheer force of will. So I think Spain will be okay in the next couple of matches. So I'd be very surprised if they don't go through. But as to who they blame, I don't know. The Spanish press, I think, are kind of equal to the British press in finding scapegoats. I'm sure they'll find someone to blame.
So that is rounding off talk about Spain, but not the World Cup. We've still got a little bit more to do with the World Cup. We're going to be talking about the American, Canadian and Mexican joint bid to host the 2026 World Cup in just a few minutes' time. But before that, introducing that topic is American Flag on the Moon by Brad Paisley. Apparently that song doesn't want to play. Never mind, we'll just move straight on to talking about the bid with America, Canada and Mexico. They beat off competition from Morocco to host the tournament in 2026, in 8 years' time. It will also be the first time that the competition's been held in the Americas since the USA had it just themselves in 1994. In my opinion, a very sensible awarding, especially when you compare it to the stadia that Morocco has compared to that of America. That's just a quick scroll through. So the highest capacity in America is the Michigan Stadium, almost 110,000, which was the attendance recorded, is the highest ever for a football match in America. I don't know if it might even be worldwide. Between Real Madrid and Manchester United, they've also got 102 capacity stadium in Ohio, five more over 90,000. In fact, if you want to find a stadium which is less than 50,000, the 34th biggest stadium in America has fewer than 50,000. That is the most under 50,000. Even in Canada, they've got the Olympic Stadium, 61,000. Commonwealth Stadium, 56,000. America, the world-famous Azteca, 87,000. The Olympico Universitario, 72,000, and so on. Morocco, they're trying to build their biggest stadium. That was proposed. So it's, as far as I'm concerned, it's very, very clear that both, or the trio of America, Canada, and Mexico are all very, very well prepared to host this World Cup. They could probably host it tomorrow if given the chance. So, Tony, do you think that it was good? It was the wise choice from FIFA and the right choice from FIFA to award it to those three countries, or do you think that they should have given it to Morocco?
Well, given the choice here between the American, Canada, and Mexico bid and Morocco, it seems like there was only really one choice. I think it's a real shame that the World Cup can't go to different places, and obviously it'd be great to have the second ever African World Cup. But especially with the competition being expanded to 48 teams, I just don't see how logistically it was ever going to be possible that Morocco could host it. As you said, they don't have the stadiums at the moment. It was all based on potential stadiums that aren't built yet. I don't know. I've never been to Morocco. I'd love to go. I'm sure it's a beautiful country, but I don't know if their infrastructure would have been able to cope with the just having 48 teams and all their fans, whereas America, the US obviously, Mexico's hosted World Cups before. Canada, I think they're going to have three venues there. It's a country that has got big stadiums and good infrastructure and hotels for everyone to stay. I just don't see how. In fact, I was thinking the other day about whether there will ever be a World Cup that is held in just one country in future, with 48 teams. I don't think, probably the US might have been the only country that could have held it on its own, and even they've gone for a joint bid.
Do you think that the joint bid is something that is going to become commonplace, not just with the World Cup, but even with the European Championship? Because in 2020, that's going to be hosted all throughout Europe, not just in one or two countries. And in my opinion, that kind of defeats the purpose of the Championship. It's quite nice when one country or two countries can put on a show, and it's all very much all about that country. That country can increase its own profile. Even though I don't agree with the Qatar bid, even though the fact that Qatar, who's never qualified for a World Cup, can enter the World Cup. But with the more countries that are going to be hosting it, first of all, is it not going to be the case that, you know, if six countries host it, you can't have six countries that automatically qualify, can you?
Well, I was looking into it. I think with this triple sort of hosting, I think America, Canada and Mexico are all going to be automatically qualified, aren't they? So I presume, I don't know. I think you're right, though. One of the wonderful things about the World Cup, and I was not entirely sure about this one being hosted by Russia, really, because obviously we have problems politically with Russia hosting it. But I'm already learning things about Russia that I never knew, and I think it's fantastic that you have a host country and you find out a bit more about that country, and you learn about different places within there and their stadiums, their football teams, their football culture, and the people. So I think that is going to be very diluted, and we're going to lose that when we have lots of joint bids. And also not just joint bids, but it'll probably be between the same countries over and over again. We're going to start to see more repeat World Cups at places we've not long been to, I think.
Is that bad a thing, though? Because certainly looking at the Qatar bid, they really shouldn't be hosting the World Cup, either logistically, because it's just... for human rights reasons in itself, the fact that they've never qualified for a World Cup. There's so many reasons why Qatar shouldn't be hosting the World Cup. I guess it speaks for itself, given recent history with FIFA, why they did get the World Cup. But it seems to me that the countries that are best equipped, both in terms of having the stadia to accommodate all the different fans and the different teams, etc., and just the quality of teams that would be qualifying anyway, would it not... Would you rather have countries that should never be qualifying for the World Cup and really, for political reasons or otherwise, just shouldn't be hosting it for that reason as well? Or is it the other hand that, yes, it will be the same countries that are hosting it within a kind of 30, 40 year cycle, but they're the teams that would be qualifying off their own merit anyway?
Yeah, I think that's a good point, actually. I mean, personally, I'd like to see it spread around a little bit. I don't agree with Qatar having it, but maybe if Qatar had been in a bid, perhaps with like Saudi Arabia or another nearby country, it could have spread it around a bit more. I mean, because the Middle East is obviously a huge region of the earth that has never had a World Cup. I suppose you're right. It's difficult for countries to build up a pedigree in international football if they don't get a chance to perhaps host a tournament and gain a bit of experience. So... I think I fudged the answer there. I don't really know which side to go on.
It's such a difficult topic, though, because there's so many different aspects that get opened up. For example, should Africa be allowed to host another tournament so soon after South Africa had it in 2010? Should it go to Europe, even though Europe isn't getting it that often anymore? Russia, you know, half Europe, half Asia. Should it be given to a completely minuscule country? I guess in terms of footballing prowess like Qatar, or even a smaller team like, I don't know, let's say Tuvalu or Vanuatu, one of those sort of small Pacific countries, should it be given? How far do you want to spread this World Cup? Do you want to give it so that it's open to everyone, even with 48 teams? That's opening it up to teams that really shouldn't be qualifying, but the more teams you allow in, the more that you're going to get the weaker teams entering, aren't you?
I think FIFA are kind of split, aren't they, in how they need the World Cups to be successful and profitable for them, but they also do want to spread football sort of more globally, which is why we had the sort of South African World Cup and why it went to America in 94, which I think was a good thing, because America's started to embrace soccer, as they call it now, football, and so I think it's nice to bring in new countries and let them host it, but I think you've got to balance that with whether they actually are capable of hosting it. I mean, the Qatar one is clearly a financial reason, I think.
Yeah, of course. Well, the reason is there can't be.
And it's going to cause a whole... It's going to be very odd, isn't it? Because I believe it's going to be held just before Christmas, isn't it? Or over
wintertime
rather than
summer. Yes,
which messes
up a whole other range of problems.
So the repercussions, yeah, it's going to affect all the European football leagues, and it's going to be interesting. I'm still kind of the opinion that I'm not entirely sure it still will happen in Qatar. I remember sort of because in 86 when Mexico ended up hosting it again, and they'd only hosted it 16 years previously, they stepped in because it was supposed to go to Colombia.
Yeah.
And I can't remember the exact reasons for it now, but it didn't end up happening in Colombia, and Mexico stepped in and held it. I'm kind of half wondering whether that'll happen with Qatar.
We've had one question in about the World Cup in general. I think it's rewinding it a little bit to what we've had before, coming from Sahil. He's asking us, what do we think about Cristiano Ronaldo's suspended sentence? This may play into a little bit of what we're talking about later on, but obviously the news in the last couple of days that for tax evasion, he has been given, it's a 2-year suspended sentence for something in excess of 16 million euros as a tax bill. Do you think that he answered the Spanish in the right way by scoring a hat-trick against them?
Yeah, I think he told him exactly what he thought of that, didn't he?
Well, that's what Tony and I think. Going to be a bit less of what I think now and more a bit of what Tony thinks in the next half an hour or so. This is the halftime section of the show. This is where it becomes less about me, all about the guest. So, Tony, your first song. What do you want us to play for you?
Together in Electric Dreams.
And why have you gone for this song?
Just because I'm a child of the 80s, really. I was born in the 70s, but I grew up in the 80s, so I think this is probably a real pinnacle of 80s synth pop kind of music. It's cheesy, but it's great.
As good a reason as any. This is Together in Electric Dreams.
Where is it coming from? Beats me. Bailey, get back here.
childhood as well, eh, Joan? Quite a sad childhood. My mum and dad were very poor growing up. We were so poor that we lived in an anorak. Thank you. And I tell you, it's tough growing up in the hood.
More wonderful comedy there from Tony Coward, who we're talking all about right now. So, Tony, you are an Ipswich fan. I assume that that's where you're from originally.
Yeah, I was born in Ipswich and grew up in Suffolk until I was about 11, 12 years old.
So, what was your first game at Portman Road?
Oh, at Portman Road? I don't actually know. I know that the first match I ever went to, my dad took me to a friendly game because we lived in a place called Stowmarket. And it was Stowmarket Town versus Ipswich. I think it was a testimonial match. And it was the Ipswich team under Bobby Robson in 1980 that then went on the next year to win the UEFA Cup. And Ipswich won 15-0. So, and it's been downhill ever since. It's never been quite as good as that.
That might answer my next question, which is, what's the best game that you've seen at Portman Road?
And that game wasn't even at Portman Road. That was away from home. That was at Stowmarket Town. Best match at Portman Road I've ever seen. I've seen us beat Norwich at Portman Road, which is always good to win the derby. Probably the best match I remember was when Ipswich were back in the Premier League and qualified for the UEFA Cup and played Inter Milan, and we won 1-0 at home against Inter Milan. Alan Armstrong scoring a goal in about the 81st minute, I think, to win 1-0. And we'd played them off the park, really. It was a great game. And the atmosphere was just amazing.
Yeah, it's an absolute shame. Obviously, Ipswich, I think it was in their first season back, they got qualification into the UEFA Cup. And then it's all gone downhill from there, really, hasn't it? We are going to talk about
unfortunately.
It a little bit later on. Don't look, upset you too much. But we are going to get on to that a bit later. A few more quick five questions. So, best game you've seen, not just at Portman Road, not just at the ground, but even on telly. Just not even Ipswich, just generally. Best match you've seen?
Oh, best match I've ever seen. Well, the best match I've ever seen where I've been at the ground was probably, I went to a lot of the Euro 96 games, so I saw England, Holland, the famous 4-1 victory at Wembley. That was probably the best match I've ever actually been to. Best match I've seen on TV. I have a bit of a thing about not really liking Brazil because everyone seems to love Brazil and they're supposed to be everyone's second best team and everyone goes on about Brazil being the sort of pinnacle of world football. So I have to say I did quite enjoy at the last World Cup the semi-final with Germany 7 Brazil 1.
Okay.
To see Brazil get humiliated in Brazil in the Maracanã, it sounds a bit cruel, doesn't it, but I did take some pleasure from that.
What about the worst game you've ever seen?
Oh, the worst game I've ever seen. There's just too many. During the mid to late 80s, Ipswich were absolutely awful. And we'd been really good at the beginning of the 80s, but towards the end we were terrible. So I just saw way too many really, really bad games at Portman Road, then under a manager called John Duncan. And then recently under Mick McCarthy, we've had some stinkers as well. I can't think of the worst match I've seen, really. Just any game where it's just 0-0 and absolutely nothing happens.
So it sounds like you're happy with the departure of Mick McCarthy then?
Because of the job I do and I'm working most weekends, I don't get to see as many matches as I'd like nowadays. So I wasn't as vociferous against Mick McCarthy as a lot of the people that had to watch Ipswich play recently. So I'm sort of sad to see him go. He'd done quite a good job on a tight budget, but I think it was probably about the right time that he needed to leave. He clearly wasn't happy there. He was unhappy with the fans, and the fans weren't particularly happy with him, so I suppose it was a mutual dislike at the end.
But it's obviously an encouraging new manager coming in, Paul Hurst, who won promotion with Grimsby from the National League via the playoffs. Almost did the same thing last season with Shrewsbury, losing in the League One final to Rotherham. And when he took over at Shrewsbury, they were bottom of League One. So it's exciting times for Ipswich, surely.
Yeah, it is exciting. I'm quite pleased with the appointment of Paul Hurst because for a long time it was looking like we might appoint one of the... There's a bit of a roving band of sort of middle-aged managers in there or getting older managers now. You're kind of like with Sam Allardyce and Pardew and
I always think of Gary Mex and those sort of people.
Yeah.
And I was just dreading that we were going to get like a journeyman manager who'd been all around the leagues, never really done very much, and would just be a bit boring. So no, a young up and coming manager who seems to have some ambition and will hopefully get us playing better football and get us moving up would be great. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
Good stuff. And a couple more quick fire questions for you. Best and worst player that you've ever seen wearing an Ipswich shirt?
Best players I've ever seen wearing an Ipswich shirt. I'm a bit too young to really. I mean, the stock answer for that is people like Arnold Muir and Franz Tyson. I saw John Walk had 3 spells with Ipswich, and he was fantastic every time he played for us. My favourite players, though, probably Marcus Stewart was a real favourite of mine. Scored 19 goals in that league campaign where we finished 5th. Because I'm a left-footed footballer and I used to play up front, and he was a left-footed striker, and he just was probably one of my favourite. And my other favourite, real bit of a cult hero at Ipswich, and it sort of ties in with the match that's being played now, was Herman Hreiðarsson.
Oh yes, yeah.
The Icelandic player who was I just thought he was fantastic. He was a great, big, solid player. He quite often used to play as a fullback, though, and I remember one time seeing him kind of do like a one of those, I don't know what they call it, what do they call the 360 kind of Zidane spins, you know, where
the roulette,
yeah, he kind of did one of those down the wing one time and ran off, and it just looked so ridiculous because he was like 6'4" and built like a brick outhouse, and so I had a real soft spot for Herman Hreiðarsson.
Worst player then?
Oh, worst player, God, I've seen some terrible. During the dark days of the late 80s, we had a player called Graham Harby, who was just an awful, awful fullback. And he used to, all he could do was just boot it up the field, hoofball. He was pretty awful. We had a period in the 90s as well when we were in the Premier League for a little while, when everyone, it was just around the time of USA 94, when all the clubs were bringing in exotic foreign players. Spurs kind of got Klinsmann and the Romanian guys they had, Dumitrescu, and Ipswich was supposedly after a South American player, and the rumours were that it was going to be Batistuta
from
Fiorentina. We were supposedly going to buy Batistuta, and in the end we got a Uruguayan guy called Adrian Paz, who you'll have never heard of him, and there's a reason for that, is because he really wasn't very good. So we went from like possibly getting like Serie A's top scorer Batistuta, who was obviously a fantastic Argentinian, to getting this unknown Uruguayan guy really didn't do very well.
I mean, it could be sort of the Ali Dia of Southampton. It wasn't quite that bad.
Yeah, he wasn't. He did actually play a few matches. He didn't, because Ali Dia only made about, what was it? He was substituted.
One, but he wasn't actually a professional footballer for one.
Yeah, didn't he claim to be George Weah's cousin?
Yeah.
I think, didn't he? He was brought on as a substitute and then was substituted off.
Yes.
20 minutes later.
That's right. So, yeah.
By Graham Sears.
One of the highlights of the Premier League era, without any doubt. Final quick fire question. We're going to just progress a little bit further. Then, your favourite home kit of Ipswich's?
Oh, my favourite home kit has to be the kit we won the UEFA Cup in. It was like a blue. Lovely blue, because I don't know if you see this with football teams, the colour of their kit seems to vary a little bit now.
And like, yeah, different shades of the same colour. Yeah,
I remember Arsenal a few years back having, they had like a blackcurrant colour, didn't they?
Anniversary of Highbury, because they were leaving Highbury, I think. Yeah,
it just seems very wrong. But Ipswich in the 80s had a royal blue, it was called Royal Blue, and it was just a lovely blue colour, and it was a pinstripe Adidas kit that they won the UEFA Cup in, and it was just, I don't think that'll ever be beat for me. It was just perfection. It was just lovely.
Do you own one?
I don't, but I was looking, Ipswich do retro kits, and I was looking at one online the other day thinking I really must buy one of these.
Definitely would be investing in one, surely.
Yeah.
Hang on to your second requested song. What have you gone for and why?
My second requested song is It's a Sin by the Pet Shop Boys. As I say, a child of the 80s, I was really like the Pet Shop Boys. I think it's their best song.
This is the Pet Shop Boys with It's a Sin.
Thank you. You're listening to Solihull Radio.
My mum and dad got divorced when I was little as well, that's sad, isn't it? My mum was having an affair with a demolitions expert. Bloody home wrecker.
I'm joined once again by Tony Cowles, another wonderful joke that, you know, I just, when I was listening to those the last couple of days, I just could not stop laughing. How do you think of these funny jokes?
I don't know, a lot of them come to me when I'm walking my dog, and I just think of silly phrases and things, and then come up with daft jokes, put them on Twitter, or try them out live. I've always had one of those brains that kind of never stops kind of thinking and coming up with silly ideas and analysing words and how words go together.
So forgive me if I get any of this information wrong. I confess that my source was Wikipedia for this. But you studied chemistry at the University of Salford and you graduated in 94, yeah?
Yeah, that's right.
So that's not exactly conducive to a career in comedy, is it?
No.
How did you get into it then?
Well, I never really kind of, it was weird because I studied chemistry. I had ideas of becoming like a forensic scientist or something like that, but never actually progressed with that. And I got working for a company in London that did sound and lighting equipment for theatres and conferences and that sort of thing. And then my boss there started running a comedy night, and about the same time, sort of late 90s, early 2000s, comedy was a massive thing in London where I was living at the time. I used to go and see a lot of stand-up comedy and just kind of got really into it.
The thing is, a lot of people tend to be modest. They don't like to say that they're good at something. But you must know that you're funny. You must have that confidence in yourself that your jokes are funny enough to not just write them, but to perform them in front of other people and expect, or at least hope, that they're going to find them as funny as you do.
Yeah, when you put it like that, it does make me wonder where I get that confidence from. It's weird, isn't it? I don't know, because I've always been quite an introverted person, really, quite shy when I was at school. Now, I wouldn't say I was the class joker, but I was a bit of that stereotype of the one that would be a bit cheeky to the teachers and be a bit funny. But that was always amongst friends and stuff. So yeah, how I've come to now be the person that gets up on stage and have the confidence to think, right, I thought this was funny. You're clearly all going to think this is funny as well. I'm not entirely sure where that comes from.
Do you ever practice on anyone? Wife, other members of your family or friends? Or do you just very much rehearse in front of the mirror? Or, you know, how do you practice?
I mean, if I think of something funny, I will. I don't have my own children, so I'm not a dad, but I'm very much a dad jokes kind of person, in that if I think of something daft or silly, I will just say it to the people that I'm with. So I apologise to the people that spend a lot of time in my company, because they do get a lot of really bad jokes said to them. Otherwise, comedy is a bit weird in that you can write and you can practice and you can rehearse, you can do whatever, but at the end of the day, you don't know that the jokes work until you actually do them in front of an audience. So a lot of comedy clubs run new material nights. In fact, not far from here in Birmingham at the Glee Club, they do a once a month night on a Sunday there called Rough Works, where about half a dozen, seven, eight comedians go on and try about 5-10 minutes of new material, and that's always good fun. It's funny. I've spoken to like Milton Jones and Tim Vine and Gary Delaney, who are comedians that I really look up to, and they've all sort of said the same thing, in that they never really have much more than about a 50-50 hit rate of jokes that they think are funny that actually work. And I've had it before where I've written a joke and I've thought, oh, that's brilliant, that's really, really funny. Try it in front of an audience and get absolutely nothing. And then something else where you think, I don't think this is a very good joke, and you're almost reluctant to do it on stage, but perhaps you do it because you're just desperate for anything to fill the time, so you just chuck that joke out there and then it gets a big laugh.
Of course, your talents aren't just confined to the stage. You've also contributed to different newspapers, different other radio shows. So how have you managed to have the proverbial finger in so many different pies?
I think that's just through necessity of being freelance, in that you do whatever people are willing to give you a bit of money for. So I've written jokes that have turned up in, as you say, in newspapers and radio shows. I even wrote some Christmas cracker jokes. Anyone that wants some jokes. So if anyone out there need some jokes for anything, I've written speeches and wedding speeches and stuff. Feel free to get in touch.
So what's the favourite Christmas cracker joke of yours that you've written?
My favourite, I don't know if it was anyone else's, but I wrote a Christmas cracker joke. So obviously Christmas cracker jokes are very formulaic. They're a question and an answer. So my Christmas cracker joke was, who is the saddest person at the pasta factory? And the answer is, the man who's filling cannelloni.
Oh, no. You can't forgive some of these, can you?
No, well, part half of the fun of a Christmas cracker joke is that it's pretty terrible.
And something else I thought was really fascinating and really quite intriguing was that you also write jokes for greetings cards.
Oh, yeah, I've done that in the past, yeah.
Yeah, so what's your favourite greeting card joke, or is it a bit too risque to reveal on air?
No, I don't think I ever really did any that were particularly risque. I have a joke that they used for a Christmas, not a Christmas card, a birthday card, because I have a joke that's people say that 40 is the new 30, but try telling that to a speed camera.
I think we have either got that one coming up, or that might be the one that we couldn't play. No, not at all. No, that is definitely one of my favourites. I tell that to my mum when I'm about to set off on a long drive.
Yeah.
Don't think she'd forgive me for that.
They used that obviously it worked for a 40th birthday. I think they might have actually changed it as well. They might have used it for 50th as well, so 50 is the new 40.
Just so, so clever. And hopefully you're going to be equally as clever in your Ipswich Town quiz.
Oh God, I'm dreading this because I should know a lot about it, but I'm sure you're going to probably find my weak areas.
So hopefully it's going to start off relatively easy and get progressively harder. Obviously I'm not an Ipswich fan, so I don't know what's hard and what isn't. For each question apart from question two, I'm just going to let you see if you can answer the question by yourself without any help from me. Okay. If you get that right, you get 2 points. If you get the answer correctly with multiple choice, you'll get just 1 point, and we'll see how you get on.
Okay.
So, are you ready, Tony Carrolls, for your Ipswich Town quiz?
I'm quite competitive, so yeah, let's go for this.
Let's see. Question number one. In what year was Ipswich Town founded?
As a professional club, I think it was 1938. But as a club, when they were an amateur club, I think it was 1896? Don't know.
Oh, I've got here 1878.
Oh, 1870. Oh, yeah, I should remember that, because it was 100 years before we won the FA Cup.
The same year as Everton and Manchester United.
Yeah.
So.
Well, that's not a good start, is it?
Good start, yeah, 0 out of 1. Question number 2. So, as I said before, this isn't going to be multiple choice, because there are 2 answers to this question. Can you name the 2 former Ipswich Town managers that have also managed England?
I'd have to revoke my Ipswich Town supporters licence if I couldn't do this. Sir Ralph Ramsey and Sir Bobby Robson.
Of course, that is correct. 2 points for you there. Question number 3. Who was the last man to manage Ipswich in the Premier League?
The last man was George Burley.
Again, correct. Another 2 points. Question number 4. Who is the only current member of the Ipswich squad that comes from outside Europe?
Ooh.
See, that get a bit harder, aren't they?
When did you get the information for this? Because
yesterday.
Yesterday.
Oh, yeah, okay. So I can give you multiple choice if you'd like.
Because I would have said Tommy Smith, who's a Kiwi, but I think he's gone now.
Yeah, I think he has as well.
So outside of Europe. You might have to give me. Hang on. Let me see. Let me think.
Okay.
No, you might have to give me multiple choice.
Okay, is it A, Cole Skews? Is it B, Tom Adeyemi? Or C, Ben Falami?
I'm trying to think where Cole Skews is from. I'm going to have to guess at this. Tom Adeyemi?
It is Ben Falami, who is from Australia.
Oh, Ben.
I think the other two are both English, or certainly represent England at youth level. Question number 5. Which Ipswich player was named the PFA Player of the Year in 1981?
This is a good question. Because Ipswich, I've got to try and get the right one, because Ipswich, I think, got all 3 of the top positions. I believe it was the Dutchman Frans Tyson. If it wasn't...
It was not. I'm prepared to give you multiple choice on this one. It may not help you.
Was it John Walker?
It was. I'll give you 1 point.
Yeah.
1 point. Okay, question number 6. Who was Ipswich Town's top scorer in the 99-2000 season? that being the season that you won promotion back to the Premier League, if I remember correctly.
Well, I'd be shocked if I didn't get this one right, because that's my favourite, Marcus Stewart.
No, it was not.
1990-2000?
No, it was David Johnson.
Oh, that's the season before, yeah. That's only cost. No.
So, what was that you said? Were you going to be shocked if you get it wrong?
This has all gone a bit Lapetegui, hasn't it? It's all gone a bit
yeah.
wrong.
Maybe we can recoup some of that.
I love David Johnson as well, but he scored all the goals that got us promoted.
Yeah,
and then Marcus Stewart scored all the goals in the Premier League.
I'm sure every time that you hear his name from now on, you're going to have a little sort of wretch at the thought that one time you were on the Josh Samuel show, you got it wrong.
Yeah.
Question number 7 is leading Paul Hurst, who is yet to manage a game. Who is Ipswich's shortest reigning manager?
Because we've had some. Does this include kind of like caretaker managers?
No, just full time managers.
Shortest reigning manager. We didn't have Jim McGilton for too long. I'm guessing it's a fairly recent one. Paul Jewell, Jim McGilton. Roy Keane was there a couple
of
seasons.
And this is, by the way, in terms of how long they were managing the club and not necessarily how many games they managed.
Okay.
I'll take a guess
at Jim McGilton.
It is Mick O'Brien, the first manager of Ipswich Town from 1936 to 1937, which is, I think, what you were alluding to earlier on.
Yeah.
39 games, 25 won, 9 drawn and 5 lost.
I'll be absolutely honest with you, I didn't even know we'd ever had a manager called Mick O'Brien.
That's okay. So, question number 8, in a similar vein, which might not bode so well if you're saying that. Excluding Paul Hurst, which Ipswich manager has had the worst win percentage at Portman Road?
Oh, at Portman Road.
So that's not just home games, I just mean as Ipswich manager.
Who had a bad? I know Mick McCarthy started to get bad at the end. Go on, we'll go with the manager that I really didn't like. We'll go with John Duncan.
So John Duncan had a win percentage of 45.3.
Yeah.
That is significantly better than that of Jackie Milburn, who had 19.6. The answer is Jackie Milburn.
Jackie Milburn, yeah, who was manager just before Bobby Robson. Although, to be honest, in my defence, I wasn't alive when he was.
Well, I certainly wasn't. Not a problem. So don't forget, you can ask me for multiple choice if you're really not sure.
Oh, yeah,
we can go to question number 9 out of 10. In the film Escape to Victory, which player stood in for Sylvester Stallone in the football scenes?
That was Paul Cooper.
Correct. Goalkeeper. Impressive.
And the goalkeeper for the German side was Laurie Civil, who was our substitute goalkeeper.
Indeed. Did you watch that film? I'm assuming you have. You know nothing
more
about it.
Many a time.
Yeah. Question number 10. Which company was the first ever shirt sponsor of Ipswich Town?
The first shirt sponsor was the audio company Pioneer.
Correct again. So, whilst we have your final song of the week playing, I'll just tally up your score and we'll get back to that in a few moments time. What is your final requested song, Tony Cowards?
My final song is song Just by Radiohead. I was a big Radiohead fan in the 90s, and I think this is I prefer this. Obviously everyone knows Creep, but I think this is actually better.
There's a small level of technical problem. I'm not quite sure why.
Sure. Equipment not like Radiohead.
It doesn't like me, I don't think. The phone last week, the music this week. No, I don't think it's going to play. I can only apologise. I think, yeah, it just doesn't like the song. I can only apologise to Radiohead, to Tony. The song isn't going to play. We'll just have to go to another of your stand-ups. Let's see if that plays. There we go. Okay, doesn't like that one either. This is going swimmingly. Never mind. So, we are just going to jump straight into the adverts. Let's see the adverts play.
fed up with condensation every morning and hate that yucky mold patch in the bathroom? It's time to contact EnviroVent. They've helped tackle mold and condensation dampness in over a million homes, just like yours. To find out more and to book a free home survey, visit EnviroVent.com, because air matters.
SolihullRadio.com.
Stagecoach Solihull teaches skills
in drama, singing and dance.
But these skills don't just vanish when the curtain falls.
They're skills for life, stretching imaginations and improving literacy.
For a career in the arts,
learning new skills,
or just having fun.
So visit our website,
www.stagecoach.co.uk/Solihull.
Stagecoach Solihull. Skills for the arts.
Skills for life.
Yeah!
The Fireplace and Stove Centre, 1204 Stratford Road, Hall Green. Specialists in wood-burning stoves, gas and electric fires, with over 50 live displays in the showroom. Come in and experience your new fireplace solutions. Call 0121 777 8585 for more details.
You're listening to Solihull Radio.
Indian Dream on Dovehouse Parade, Solihull's premier family-run restaurant offering authentic Indian and Bangladeshi cuisine. With fresh ingredients and creative chefs, they can provide bespoke dining experiences, eat in or take away. 0121 704 9058.
Now, at this point, I'm aiming to play another song for you. Now, let's just see if it does work. If it doesn't, we're just going to have to move straight on. Let's just see if we can hear it. It's just teasing us now, isn't it? Okay, so we're going to play The Best by Tina Turner. So I guess you can gather where we are going with this. And that is the question of whether Cristiano Ronaldo is the greatest footballer of all time. So for anyone that doesn't know, last night against the match against Spain, he scored his 51st career hat-trick in the 3-all draw, aged 33, which is quite an age to still be scoring at such a high level, hat-tricks and breaking all kinds of records. He's a 5-time Ballon d'Or winner, joint with Lionel Messi, of course. Also, he's won the most World Soccer Player of the Year titles with 5 again. A few more stats. Only player to score in 8 major tournaments consecutively, internationally as well. Key player in title-winning campaigns in both Premier League and La Liga, with the Champions League as well. He's won everything there is to win with United and with Real Madrid. First footballer to reach 40 goals in a professional league for 2 consecutive seasons. Only player to score 50 goals or more in 6 different seasons consecutively. Only player to score 50 goals or more in 7 calendar years. I could go on with this. He's Real Madrid's all-time top scorer with 438, top scorer ever in La Liga, top goal scorer ever in the Champions League, etc. Like I said, I can just go on and on and on. Tony Cowers, I think it has to be a question of who is the best ever out of Ronaldo and Messi. Which side of the fence are you on? And please don't say you're on the fence.
What are we saying, that one of those two has to be the best player of all time?
Are you saying someone completely left field? Pele, maybe?
Yeah, John Walk. I think it's interesting that I don't know, actually, like, because people used to do the debate between Pele and Maradona, didn't they? I kind of sort of was too young to really see much of Pele, so it was Maradona for me was the best. And then I suppose Zidane was fantastic for a long time. Out of Ronaldo and Messi, I think I go from one to the other. I've always been slightly more pro Messi than Ronaldo, but in recent times I think Ronaldo, whereas Messi seems to, he's still absolutely fantastic, but he seems to be sort of starting to show his age, whereas Ronaldo seems to be getting better with age. I think it's interesting with Ronaldo as well is that he's the way he plays football seems to have changed slightly. He's gone from, obviously started off as a winger, then became kind of more of a kind of creative just behind the striker, and now he is almost an out and out centre forward and doesn't really run around too much, doesn't do too much defending, but scores obviously amazing goals. I think there is obviously the question to be had whether he is the greatest of all time. His stats certainly sort of back it up, but if I had to pick between the two, I think I'd still be just tempted to pick Messi over their whole career.
See, I'm going to give you a bit of an analysis on why I think that Ronaldo's the best, and you can tell me if you agree, disagree, comments, whatever. So I think Ronaldo's the best for several reasons. Firstly, I think that Messi was more naturally gifted, and therefore for Ronaldo to reach the same level as Messi, I think he had to work a lot harder.
Yep.
Don't get me wrong, at the age of 18, he was showing prowess, that's why United signed him in the first place. But I think if you just watch the videos of Messi when he was 10, 11, even slightly older, the way he used to dance through players was just incredible. So the fact that we can even talk about them both, we can actually legitimise the debate between the two of them, for me, suggests that I prefer Ronaldo, because he worked to get to where he is. And really, with Messi's raw talent, he should be leaps and bounds above Ronaldo. And there's also the fact that Ronaldo has done it in two different countries. He ripped apart the Premier League, aged, what, 23, 24? Went to La Liga, did the same. He's won, I believe, is it 4 Champions League titles with Real Madrid now? 1 with United? He's won everything there is to win with both clubs. And even the statistics, the fact that he is the top goal scorer of so many different leagues, clubs, tournaments, etc. And to contrast that with what I was talking about with Wayne Rooney last week, certainly with Ronaldo, there is no doubt that the statistics very much support the kind of player that Cristiano Ronaldo is. Tony, where are you on that?
Yeah, I think you make a very good case for him. I think the thing about Ronaldo working really hard is probably right. He's probably, like you say, not quite as naturally gifted perhaps as Messi, but has worked really, really hard. I mean, a lot of people don't like Cristiano Ronaldo there because they see that they think that he's arrogant, or it comes across as arrogance. But I don't really think it is arrogance. I think it is just someone who's unbelievably driven to make the absolute best of his physique and his technique and his footballing prowess. And you have to admire him for that. I think he is fantastic. I mean, we just live in an age where there's just two players who are just head and shoulders above the rest, aren't they? Their numbers, their statistics just are mind-boggling. I remember seeing a while back when Ronaldo became Real Madrid's top scorer,
yeah,
and he overtook Raul, who was obviously a fantastic striker himself, but he overtook Raul something like 300 games less,
yeah,
than Real, because he scored, I don't know what, you've probably got the figures there, but he's got, isn't it something like 400 odd goals in less, it's over a goal every game,
I think he's
got
in excess of 300 goals in fewer than 300 games. I think there's about a 20 difference between goals
whereas,
to game ratio.
Yeah, whereas Raul was like a goal every other game,
yeah,
however. So it's just incredible.
It really
like you
is.
Say 51 hat-tricks, it's just ludicrous, isn't it?
Yeah, it really is phenomenal.
Kind of every time you think perhaps you're writing him off, thinking that maybe he's... Because I sort of don't follow La Liga that closely, but he didn't have a particularly good start to the season, did he?
No, he did not.
I think
no.
He only scored a couple of goals in the first half of the season, and then everyone was kind of like, is he too old now? Is he on the decline? And then his second half of the season, he banged in tons of goals, scored that overhead kick in the Champions League. Was it the semi-final?
Yes, yeah.
And then obviously they won the Champions League again. And then he goes to the World Cup and everyone says, oh, he's never really done it at a World Cup. He's never scored a free kick, and he scores a hat-trick and scores a free kick that gets a point at the end of the right at the end of the match, doesn't he?
So we're going to talk about his progress in the World Cup in a second. I've got an email in from Lawrence asking, should Birmingham City wholesale sign the Iceland team? I don't know. So certainly improve the Birmingham City side, but what would you make of that, Tony? Wouldn't be too good for Ipswich if they can hold Argentina to a 1-1 draw in Ipswich's fight for promotion.
Yeah. What? So this guy. Sorry. What was he
asking
saying?
If Birmingham City should just sign the entire Iceland team?
Yeah, well, they seem to be a pretty good team, wouldn't they, the Iceland? And they play in blue, so they wouldn't have to change their shirt's colour, would they? They'd probably be all right.
Not sure what Everton would think of Sigurdsson going to Birmingham.
Yeah, yeah, they might be... Gylfi Sigurdsson was what? How much was he? 50 million?
Yeah, something like that.
It might
yeah,
be quite
crazy.
Expensive to buy the entire Iceland team. I don't know.
Might be better off buying the chain of supermarkets than the football team.
Yeah.
But yeah, back on to Ronaldo and the World Cup. I've neglected to mention the fact that I'm assuming you know by now, but the fact that Argentina and Iceland did draw 1-1, Messi missing a penalty, and that raises so many more questions about Ronaldo versus Messi. The fact that Ronaldo, who is 1 year older than Messi, by the way, scored a hat-trick against Spain, and Messi, failed to even score a penalty against, I guess it may be unfair to say this, but significantly weaker opposition than Spain. So is that, again, I guess as they're getting older, is that just showing the golf in class? Maybe not over the course of their entire careers, but certainly at this moment in time between Ronaldo and Messi.
Yeah, possibly. I feel a bit sorry for Messi because I do feel, I mean, I guess Ronaldo has the weight of the nation of Portugal kind of on his shoulders to a certain extent, but Messi certainly seems to have all of Argentina like hoping and just praying that he'll single-handedly carry them to World Cup. And he gets slated for not doing very well at World Cups and things, but actually at the last World Cup he had a pretty good tournament, and he did sort of get them to the final. They lost the final, but they had a pretty good run. There's a weird conundrum with Messi, isn't there? Because he doesn't have a very good record, particularly with penalties. I think he's missed quite a few for Barcelona as well. I think I remember seeing somewhere, because the most sort of on average, 75% of penalties are scored, 75%. Yeah. And I think Messi's average is in the low 70s. So considering he's better than most players at everything else, dribbling, scoring, all sorts of things, the fact that his penalty record is actually slightly below average for a footballer is quite a weird conundrum. I can't quite get my head around that.
And even building on the international question, Ronaldo, of course, led as captain Portugal to Euro 2016. He is still the captain, he's still leading the way. Lionel Messi, not so much. I appreciate that Messi's a bit more of a reserved character. But the fact they are both captaining their countries, they've been chosen to lead their country in international tournaments. Is it another mark of Ronaldo's character, both as a person and as a footballer, that even when he was taken off injured, he was still on the touchline, hobbling on, cheering his side on? Is it those things that that build upon the argument that he slightly edges Messi? Or do you think that being captain isn't that important in being a hallmark of a great player?
I don't know if being a captain makes a difference, but certainly the fact that he was still instrumental even when he wasn't on the pitch, wasn't he? I think obviously counts in his favour. As I say, it's I think with the Messi-Ronaldo debate, it's a hair's breadth in it, really, between the two of them. And I kind of think it sometimes you can produce as many facts and stats and everything as you want, but to be honest, people go with a slight emotional... So I don't know, to me, Messi just gets it. I'm a bit of a footballing hipster, I suppose, and in a way I prefer Barcelona to Real Madrid, and I probably slightly prefer Argentina to Portugal. So I kind of go down on the side of Messi rather than Ronaldo.
That's absolutely fair enough, even if I completely disagree with you. that is the purpose of debate. Well, I find Real Madrid's morals a bit questionable. But certainly, not just because he was at United, which a lot of people always say to me, oh, you ain't like Ronaldo because he was at United. I just think he is a phenomenal player. But like I said, the fact that we can even debate which is greatest, despite what both have achieved, says a lot about them both as players. Now, I'm changing tack slightly with how I'm going to try and play this next song. I have got an iPad in front of me. I'm yet to use it for music. I've been told about it. I've been sticking to the traditional computers, but we are going to see whether this works. So this is Just Starting Over by John Lennon, and hopefully I'm praying to God and all the other gods out there that this works. Just Starting Over by John Lennon.
Our life together is so precious. Together we have grown. We have grown. Although our love is still special, let's take a chance and fly away somewhere alone. It's been too long since we took the time. No one's to blame. I know time flies so quickly, but when I see you, darling, it'll be just like starting over.
make love? Why can't we be making love nice and easy? It's time to spread our wings and fly. Don't let another day go by, my love. It'll be just like starting
Starting Over There by John Lennon. Thank goodness that we got to listen to that wonderful song. Oh, it wants to play again. No, thank you. Okay, so something else that's starting over, a bit like John Lennon's relationship in the song, is the Premier League, with the fixtures for the 2018-19 season being released a couple of days ago. So I don't know if you've had a chance to catch these, Tony, in full, but I'll just read them out anyway for you and for our listeners. So, the opening day, Arsenal versus Manchester City, the big, big game of the opening weekend. Then there is Bournemouth versus Cardiff, Fulham hosting Crystal Palace, Chelsea travelling to Huddersfield Town, Liverpool versus West Ham, Manchester United against Leicester, Newcastle versus Spurs, Southampton hosting Burnley, Brighton travelling to Watford, and Wolves hosting Everton. I'm assuming Arsenal versus Man City stands out for you there.
Yeah, that was the biggest match, I think, wasn't it?
Yeah, without question. A big challenge there for Unai Emery, really, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a nice one for him to start off with.
Yeah.
The hardest match he could probably have. I like the fact that you're reading out all the Premier League fixtures, because as an Ipswich fan, it just rubs it in. We're not there.
Well, the Championship ones are released next week, so if you are listening, we'll have a little investigation into how Ipswich might be getting on for their season.
When did the fixtures get announced? Because I suppose it all got a bit lost with the World Cup.
Yeah, it was a couple of days ago. It was the same day that the World Cup started, actually.
Oh,
I think is why it did get so lost. Yeah. Certainly there were questions that, there's so much football happening in one go because the excitement of the Carabao Cup being released yesterday.
Yeah, the Carabao Cup.
We're going to have a little chat about that in a few minutes' time. Certainly in terms of the Premier League, though, obviously Arsenal having a very difficult start, Man City and then Chelsea, their first two games.
Do you think Arsenal have been good at home, weren't they? Last year they had a very good home form. It was just their away form, wasn't it? So maybe a home game against Man City is not quite so bad.
Do you think there's two big golf and class between the two? Do you think that Unai Emery has what it takes to close that gap? Obviously not just between Man City, who won the title by quite some way, but even the teams that finish up, we had Chelsea finishing in, was it fifth, and then Liverpool fourth, Spurs in third, United in second. I think there was a bigger gap between City and United than there was between United and Arsenal in the end. So do you think that Unai Emery has what it takes? Because his pedigree as a manager has very much been Europa League standard. He won the Europa League, I think it was three times, with Sevilla. He failed to win the league in 2017 with PSG. He's had, quite frankly, nightmares in the Champions League with PSG. So do you think he is the right man to take Arsenal, to progress them in the way that the Arsenal board would like and in the way that they've appointed him? Or do you think that they're very much going to stagnate in that fifth to sixth position in the Premier League?
Yeah, I don't know. It's tough, isn't it? It's like the Premier League is sort of... Man City was so far above everyone else. It's difficult to see Arsenal getting close. I suppose it all depends after the World Cup when probably transfers go crazy and we see who buys who.
Yeah.
I find it weird difficult with Arsenal because as an Ipswich fan, their worst season, what was it? Was last season perhaps their worst season when they lost the Europa Cup final and finished what, fifth?
Six, I think it was in the end, just
and
above
like,
Burnley.
For me as an Ipswich fan to look at that and go, that was your worst ever season. Was it? Recent times, wow, you got to a cup final and you finished in the top six. Wow, my heart bleeds for you. Tough.
All relative.
How could you possibly live with that? But yeah, different standards, isn't it, I suppose?
Yeah,
but,
it really is.
But yeah, you know, MRI seems like a bit of a sort of safe choice in a way, but slightly uninspiring. And if he sort of did okay, didn't he, with PSG?
Yeah.
But then again, doing okay with PSG is kind of pretty much anyone could manage them, couldn't they? Because they've got a massive budget compared to the rest of the French league.
See, it's quite fascinating because a lot of people that were speaking in support of the appointment of Emery were saying that when he was at Sevilla, he worked wonders with a small budget. But then you have to turn that on its head and you say, well, he had one of the biggest budgets in world football with PSG, and he really, really did underachieve there. If you look at, again, the Champions League against Barcelona in 2017, where they were 4-0 up after the first leg and ended up losing. So you have to start really picking up on these little things. You can't always say he did it on a small budget, because he's going to have, I suspect, a bigger budget at Arsenal than he had, obviously not as big as he had at PSG, but certainly bigger than he had at Sevilla. I think the longer that the Emirates is there, the longer that the Arsenal board have scope to provide him with the funds. And, you know, they've not hesitated in spending. Look at Aubameyang, even before that, Sanchez and Ozil didn't join cheaply. So I think certainly the question of Unai Emery is, I think it's very difficult to look at in some respects what he has done in the past in terms of finance, because yes, he did it with a small budget at Sevilla, but that was all relative. You know, he that was in the Europa League. He wasn't achieving at Sevilla what Arsenal would like to achieve now in going forward and trying to progress into the Champions League. But another interesting fixture list that was up is Manchester United, because they haven't got too many pressing fixtures in the first half, really. They've got, in the first 10 fixtures rather, Leicester, Brighton, Spurs, Burnley, Watford, Wolves, West Ham, Newcastle. And apart from the Spurs game, the biggest game is Chelsea, which isn't until the middle of October. So do you reckon that relatively speaking, knowing Jose Mourinho, it won't be that straightforward, but the relatively speaking easy start that United have could then give them enough of an advantage, both mathematically and psychologically, that could end up, if not taking them all the way, certainly getting very, very close to the Premier League title?
Yeah, well, I suppose, yeah, if they could make a really good start and get a bit of a lead on their challengers, who will presumably be Man City, possibly Liverpool, Tottenham, Chelsea, maybe Arsenal. But yeah, if they can get a bit of a head start, I suppose that'd be good. Because Manchester United, I mean, they were a funny team last year, weren't they?
And
with the fans, yeah. Obviously, I don't how happy you were with the season, but I mean, they finished second and obviously did you win a cup? I can't remember.
Sadly not. No, we got to the FA Cup final. I think with United, on paper, yes, it looks quite good, especially after having finishing second. We really should have won the FA Cup final, but it's the manner in which everything happened. It was the manner in which we got absolutely decimated by Man City in terms of points in the league. It was the embarrassing. It would just been beyond belief if they'd won the title against us. It was the fact that we lost to all three of the newly promoted sides. We lost to West Brom, who ended up going down. We drew with Stoke, who ended up finishing bottom. So if you look at all these, yes, okay, we had the best record of the top six against the top six, but it's those points that you should not be dropping that I think was the problem. Maybe complacency from Jose Mourinho. It is hard to say, but I think the tactics certainly were a problem for United last season. Certainly since Sir Alex Ferguson left, it's been very, very slow. Louis van Gaal era was not the most pleasurable to watch. David Moyes, I think, is not even worth talking about. So, yeah, I do suspect that Jose Mourinho it's a case of make or break time this season. But even looking at Manchester United and Manchester City, looking at the positioning of the derbies, we've got one which is in beginning of November, but then there's also one in March. And this season, the second derby is at Old Trafford. Again, do you think that could prove instrumental, provided that it is between City and United and that it is relatively quite close? Do you think the fact that United have the home advantage, that could be decisive in the title race?
Yeah, it could be. It was interesting what you were saying there about Manchester United's inability to beat the clubs down the bottom, because that is what costs them, isn't it? But I find it interesting because one of the things that people say about the Premier League as opposed to La Liga and the Bundesliga and Serie A is that, oh, the Premier League is great because anyone can beat anyone, which is generally not true. But then when the lower clubs do end up beating, say, Manchester United, so West Brom beat Man United, then all of a sudden it's like, oh, but we shouldn't have been losing to those. So yeah. It's like, well, we can either have a nice, interesting league where it's a bit there's competitiveness from the top to the bottom, or you can just have Manchester City or whoever at the top running away with it by 18 points or whatever it was.
Well, that totally builds on what I was talking about last week, which is you have to strike the balance between excitement and quality. And at the moment, I don't think we've really got either. I think, yeah, okay, it might be quite exciting that the promoted teams can beat teams like Manchester United and get points off Liverpool and et cetera, et cetera. But I think it's not like it's not possible. If you rewind to, you know, 10, 15 years ago, when there was more of a top four than a top six, so it was United, Arsenal, Chelsea and Liverpool. And each season, the team that won it, they didn't just win it because they were better than everyone else. They won it because they were a genuinely good side, fighting in Europe every single season. So I think you absolutely hit the nail on the head there, that, yeah, okay, it's exciting when teams that go down or teams that have just come up are beating the big boys. But at the end of the day, do you want excitement or do you want good football? It's a good question, isn't it?
Yeah, well, it's interesting what you were saying about the results under Jose Mourinho as well, because, like you said, on paper, when you look at it, he hasn't actually done that bad a job. You finished second to possibly the best team we've ever seen in the Premier League. Okay, you finished quite a long way behind, but you've improved season on season over the last couple of seasons, haven't you? You said you were sixth the season before.
Yeah, I think since Ferguson, it's been seventh, fourth, fifth, sixth, and then second.
Yeah, but it's interesting how... And I totally understand this with fans. Fans pay a lot of money to go to the matches. They pay a lot of money to watch on TV, pay a lot for the shirts and the merchandising. So not only do they expect teams to do well now in terms of league positions and getting to cup finals and winning cup finals, but they expect their team to do it in style now as well. And it has to be not just results, but it has to be entertaining.
Of course,
we had this at Ipswich. I mean, Mick McCarthy did not a bad job on a tight budget. He got us to the playoffs one year. But even when we got to the playoffs, there was still people moaning that we weren't playing very good football. And it's interesting. I think as football is now competing more and more with other forms of entertainment, it's not just enough for teams. The days of George Graham's Arsenal going to the title, winning almost every game 1-0, boring, boring Arsenal. It's like you can't really do that anymore.
No, absolutely. So we are going to end the show with some responses to some more of our listeners' questions and Ooh. Comments, but we are going to try it out with the iPad again with Just. So let's see if this works. This is just for you, Tony.
Thank you.
I know that you've got your reasons for choosing this song, which you mentioned before. I don't know this song apart from the 5 seconds I listened to yesterday, so I'm really interested to hear this. This is Just by Radiohead. Fingers crossed, everybody. is just loading up. Just give us a few seconds. Yeah, you've done it for us just a second ago. Oh, I think the internet might be playing games with us here. Oh, I'm afraid it wasn't to be. We'll see if we can get it on in a few minutes' time. But we have had some listeners comment with their questions.
Yep.
Can you kick off with my mum? Because she's got designs on me on Strictly Come Dancing. Oh, here we go. The song's playing. We'll get that back to your mum in just a minute. Thank you, Tony. That was a really good song after all. So, yes, as I was saying, absolutely, even if the iPad did interrupt us, but as I was saying, we did have a text from my mum, who has got designs on becoming a dancer on Strictly Come Dancing by being my mum. But the question is, what do we think of the winter break? Because We are obviously following suit of countries like Germany and even Scotland. Quite why we're following Scotland is a mystery to me. But yes, we are following Scotland in this. So, Tony, what do you think of the winter break? Good idea? Do you think it's going to be beneficial when we go to international tournaments? Or do you think that maybe it's just another distraction?
I don't know. It seems a bit weird. We're doing a winter break in a strange way, aren't we? In that there's not actually a break.
For the fans, there's not a break, but yeah, I think for the teams, they've got a week.
Yeah, 2 week break or whatever. I don't know. I have to see. Personally, I can't really see that it's going to make too much difference, but maybe because the Germans have like a really long break.
Yeah, I believe it's for 3 or 4 weeks. I know it's that Scotland, that their fixtures came out yesterday, and the Scottish, I think, is for a month as well. It's just after Christmas, and then it's for about 4 weeks. Although, if you're honest, it doesn't really help them much in Europe. So,
true.
I'm not too sure what we can really draw from that. But yeah, it's also, someone's asked about the Carabao Cup fixtures as well. I'm not going to run through all of them because we've only got 9 minutes left of the show. But looking at Ipswich's tie away to Exeter away, what do you make of that?
It should be quite interesting. Yeah, I always like it when in the League Cup when you get an away draw. I think it's quite a bit more exciting than if it was Ipswich versus Exeter at Portland Road. I don't think it'd be quite so exciting. But yeah, trip down to St James's Park, isn't it? Exeter.
Yeah, well, how far do you see Ipswich progressing in the Carabao Cup? Because being a Championship club, they're obviously not expected to do that well. You've got the top ranked Premier League teams coming in the third round, a few of the lesser Premier League teams in the second round, so there's obviously going to be bigger competition for them, provided they do beat Exeter. So do you think they've got enough to maybe go on a little bit of a cup run?
Well, let's hope so. Our record in the cups recently has been absolutely atrocious. I think in the FA Cup we hadn't got past the third round for about 10 years. We've been beaten by people like, not having a go at these teams, but we've been beaten by like Northampton, Stevenage, Borough, and various other.
It's not quite football against MK Dons, though, is it?
No, that's true. But yeah, not so long ago we had a fairly decent League Cup run to the semi-finals where we got beaten by Arsenal in the year they got beaten in the final by Birmingham City. The guy that got in touch earlier wanting the Icelandic team.
Yeah.
I remember that. Yeah, hopefully we can have a bit of a run. It's always nice to have a cup run, isn't
it? But I think what is quite sad, actually, it's become, certainly if you've looked at Portsmouth in 2008 and Wigan in 2013, it's almost not worth, even Birmingham City in 2011, it's not worth having this cup run because you end up sacrificing your league status. And it's, again, one of those balance questions of, would you rather be in the Premier League, or would you rather have a trophy that you can, even in 50 years' time, hold on to? But, you know, the club isn't where it used to be. Birmingham City got relegated the same season that they won the League Cup. Wigan got relegated the same season they won the FA Cup. And Wigan haven't seen light of day since, and nor have Birmingham, really. So do you think that Ipswich could really do without that distraction of a cup run? Do you think that they should really put all their eggs into one Championship basket? Or do you think that it might be nice for the fans and a bit more revenue coming from the television money and that if they did go on a bit of a cup run?
Maybe it is because of my age, but I'm still a bit romantic about the cups, especially the FA Cup. I'd like us to have. I think if you, I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, but I think if you asked Wigan fans when they won the FA Cup but got relegated whether they'd swap winning the FA Cup for finishing 17th, and not going down, I think they'd keep the cup win. It's like when you look back through the record books in years to come, you'll see that they've won the cup. No one really takes that much notice if they got relegated. I don't know, although they did get relegated again, didn't they?
So, but they're back up again now.
I find it interesting as football now. I worry sometimes that we're not allowed to enjoy the moment of winning something or getting to a final. Because with Liverpool this year, I remember just in the build-up to the Champions League final, they were sweating on obviously qualifying into the Champions League again, weren't they, to get fourth place. And it was kind of like, it seemed to take away the focus from like, don't worry about your league position, you've got a Champions League final, like win the Champions League, then you'll qualify for the Champions League again.
Well, it worked out perfectly as far as I'm concerned. They didn't win, so I can't complain. But yes, it's funny you were saying about the fact that Wigan they're proud of the fact that they won this cup, because I did mention last week that I was going on a tour of some of the stadiums in the Northwest, one of which was the DW Stadium, which is, I'll just mention quickly, one thing I love about the DW Stadium, the owner, Dave Whelan, the stadium's named after him, He's got a statue of himself with the FA Cup outside the ground. It is just fantastic. He is my idol, quite frankly. That is what I want to be. But yeah, so we went inside and we asked if we could have a little mini tour of the stadium, which they very, very duly did. Very, very hospitable at Wigan.
Oh, lovely.
They let us hold the League One title trophy and the FA Cup, and the lady on reception said that was her proudest moment as a Wigan fan, was the FA Cup win. Naturally, you can imagine, and even she says that that's the one thing in the whole stadium that she really holds dear to her is that FA Cup trophy. So of course you can imagine, being a fan of United, I don't really have that kind of relativity of the you know, winning one trophy is a massive thing, I guess, with Barnet to an extent. But even with Ipswich and the UEFA Cup, even being Europe's secondary trophy, it's still a massive thing to have happened to Ipswich, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, still talked about to this day, and still that team is idolised in Ipswich.
Yeah.
Nearly 40 years later. Obviously this year was the 40th anniversary of Ipswich winning the FA Cup in 1978, which is the only time we've ever won the FA Cup.
Yeah.
And it's just a massive thing for a club like Ipswich.
Yeah, certainly be interesting when the ties are played, and certainly some of the other ties, as Blackpool and Barnsley. Blackpool looking to get back into the Championship, so they probably could do it without the Cup run as well. And then there's Leeds and Bolton, that Championship tie there, which is certainly another interesting. Bolton obviously having some problems in the Championship last season, but trying to get back to where they were. But that is going to have to draw our couple of hours with you to a close. That is sadly all we've got time for this week. A massive thank you to Tony once again, Tony Cowles, being a wonderfully, truly wonderful guest
this week.
Not a problem, and we have to come on again sometime for sure.
Yeah,
he's also hoping for a victory for the Three Lions on Monday against Tunisia. I'll be back, same place, same time next week, discussing that and much, much more. And have a wonderful Father's Day to everyone. And sticking with that theme, I have had my dad in the studio for the whole time, just seeing how everything goes on in Solihull Radio HQ. And to that end, I'm going to be playing a song just for him and for all the other fathers out there on Father's Day. This is Alan Clark and Dane Clark. They are father and son. And this song is called Father and Friend. Let's just hope that the iPad doesn't let me down again. Thank you all so, so much for tuning in once again. I'll be back next week, hopefully with another top draw guest. Until then, thanks for listening, and I'll see you then.
Oh, Papa, sit down and hear my song. Oh, and if you feel like it, then please sing along. No, nothing that I want to say I haven't said before, but to use your words, you can never be too sure. See, even though I don't always show, I'm glad that you're around. I said I'm glad that you're around. Oh, son, it's so strange to hear and see that someone so different is a soul like me. Oh, that's why I wanna tell you that I love you very much.